Someone's cursing my lord. Late night lunch. Someone's puffling my lord. Late night lunch. Someone's growing my lord. Late night lunch. Oh lord, late night lunch.
This is a post-Watershed production.
Hello and welcome to the People's Temple Lardian Church, Disciples of Large. I will prepare your final meal before you are violated by our saviour, Mike Large.
Hello, my disciples.
And I hope you'll all join us, join hands and savour our final offerings before we depart to a better place.
Well, they better be good offerings, otherwise I'm sending you all to hell.
I hope you're going to enjoy tonight's show, because...
Bring me virgins or food.
It's been something I've been wanting to chew over for a while. Chew the gristle of.
Chew the gristle or something.
Tonight's theme is really cults. Mike, tell me what you know about cults. I mean, you must have found
a few
yourself.
I'm glad you are, because very little.
Very little. Well, I'm sure you founded a few yourself, haven't you?
Well, I'm pretty iconic, godlike, and people do tend to follow me.
Mike, what do you understand to be a cult? If somebody referred to something as a cult, I'd imagine that it'd probably be disparagingly, wouldn't it?
Yeah, group of nutters doing crazy shit. Mm. Yeah, that's because they think something that's just stupid.
Okay. Do you think brainwashing comes into it?
Sometimes.
Indoctrination?
Yeah, it does.
Okay, so
as well as stupidity.
Well... maybe gullibility, we'll say, naivety.
Stupidity.
Okay, well, tell me, what's the difference between a cult and, say, the Nazis?
Why? You always have to bring up the Nazis. We've gone so long without mentioning them.
Well,
so long.
Reduce your ad Hitlerum, but... no, seriously, the difference between a cult and Nazis. Because, obviously, a cult... let me understand what you're saying. A cult is a subversive kind of ideology that's indoctrinated into some vulnerable people and generally leads to some bad shit.
Yeah.
Okay, so what makes it different from, say, you know, the National Socialist Movement of Germany, the Third Reich? What's the difference? Did Hitler not indoctrinate...
I don't think there is a difference.
Well, I'd say probably the difference is... it's perceived to be a minority, isn't it? Whereas if it's dominant ideology, then it's not considered a cult. For instance, we could consider materialism a cult, where people are brainwashed by constant advertisements.
I guess.
Reality TV. People are more likely to vote for the latest douchebag on X Factor than people who represent them, that kind of thing.
Isn't cult usually, like, to the religion and stuff, though?
Okay, so you're going to throw a religious thing in it. So you think it's more defined by religion rather than anything else?
Well, it's a set of ideals and beliefs, isn't it? Which normally stem from religious views.
Okay.
In my understanding of cults, normally.
I'll buy that. I think you're probably right. If we just refer to our sponsor quickly. It does definitely mention religion. Religion is intrinsically connected to the word cult. Can you think of a reason why?
No.
Can you think of a reason why?
Possibly.
You made me lose my train of thought, you penis.
So easy.
God's sake. Can you think...
Can I think of a reason why?
Yeah. Can you think of a reason why most successful cults, and when I say successful, obviously if a movement attracts a certain number of devotees who, you know, stick around to the end, you'd consider it probably successful. Why do you think cults are successful when religion is a big part? What do you think makes religious cults successful? Whereas, okay, let me give you another example. Say I was to start a cult based on love of shredded wheat.
I hear you. I love shredded wheat.
Yeah. Now, if I proclaim myself to be the all-seeing deity of the shredded wheat appreciation lobby,
yes,
and put down this set of beliefs, and I said, all of us must have shredded wheat for three meals a day, we must create art and poetry dedicated to shredded wheat, we must throw ourselves at the altar of shredded wheat every night at 6 o'clock, these kinds of things. I don't imagine a lot of people would follow it. In fact, I'd be very surprised if anyone did, unless they were heavily intoxicated.
I'd follow it.
What I mean is, Mike, why do you think religion is the key word in successful cults? Can you think of any reason?
I don't know.
Without meaning to insult every other major religion, but do you not think it's because religion claims to have an answer? A simple kind of answer to all of the world's problems?
And a lot of people do kind of seek that, don't they?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's what I mean.
I guess...
I kind of see that that's what would attract people.
I guess
people
that's why people believe in any religion. Look at a cult as a religion, like, then...
But I think, you've got to be careful not to insult certain people, though.
No, but do they not... Is it not...
I don't think people necessarily join religion just for easy answers.
For easy answers, but because they believe they are the answers, or they have the answers, and they believe them to be true, whatever that religion may be.
Yeah. Whereas, even slightly more intelligent people, they could look at the major religions... Sorry, slightly less deluded, not more intelligent... I mean, I'm talking about compared to people who are successfully pulled into cults, Mike.
Okay,
not religious people.
Okay, go on then.
No, slightly less deluded people, i.e. non-cult people, who might tinker with major religion, they might see major religion, let's face it, is responsible for most of the major warfare in the last few centuries, especially Islam and Christianity, and Zionism, whatever.
Along with oil and stuff.
Yeah, but you look at religion, it's been right at the forefront. Major religion. So, you have people, say, who are looking for, some kind of spiritual salvation. They look to the major religions and they think, hang on, they haven't got any of the answers. In fact, they're making things worse. You know, all these wars over territories and Islam versus Christianity or Zionism versus Islamic fundamentalism, whatever you want to call it. And they might think, what's needed is fresh answers, and that's surely where cults come in, where somebody says, hey, listen, I've got this new religion, it's not like any of these major religions that have failed us for so long, you're going to be part of a special movement because not many people see what's happening, you're one of the few enlightened people. That's got to be pretty attractive to people when they're looking for something different.
I guess I struggle to put myself in a situation where it would appeal to me.
That's what you said earlier when we were talking about the pro-paedophile lobby. Do you remember that?
Yes.
What did you think of that?
You're a founding member, aren't you?
Seriously, that was a joke. But
I wasn't joking.
Shut up. I don't know how many people know. I was only made aware recently that there was actually a pro-paedophile
movement. My ass made aware recently.
Well, considering it disbanded 2 years after I was born, there was a pro-paedophile lobby in the UK, an active pro-paedophile lobby in the UK, and in fact there have been pro-paedophile lobbies across the world. They obviously get disbanded pretty quickly when their activities become well known, but I don't know, some people might call that a cult, but I just thought it was an interesting point because Mike's reaction was quite funny.
Bloody mental, isn't it,
Mike? We're going to talk about, I was thinking we'd look at very basic level of study of cults, because there's a very cool part on the mind control aspect that's on, well, it's on Wikipedia, but it's a number of studies identifying key steps in coercive persuasion, rather.
Ah, something I'm quite good at.
So I've heard. Duress is a word I often hear associated with you. So here we go. There's
undress.
Oh. And durex. So, the 5 points that they make about coercive persuasion or brainwashing. Number one, people are put in physically or emotionally distressing situations.
Yeah.
Right, that's not something to laugh at. Number two, their problems are reduced to one simple explanation, which is repeatedly emphasised.
We have the answer to all of your problems.
There's the religious aspect. Number three, they receive what seems to be unconditional love, acceptance and attention from a particularly charismatic leader,
Mike Large,
and the group. Number four, they get a new identity based on the group.
I should run a cult.
So that's how you break people down. You say, you're not the person you were outside, now you are.
Your name is not Aaron Bliss, your name is now
Number Seven.
Large Tony and Seven.
Yeah, something like that. And number five, they are subject to entrapment, isolation from friends, relatives and mainstream culture, and their access to information is severely controlled. Does that mean China's a cult? So these views are disputed by some scholars, but I mean, that's a good starting point anyway. Do you agree with those 5 points? Does that make sense to you? I mean, obviously, yeah. We're scholars.
Yes, obviously. But yeah, no, it does. I was just thinking how I should probably run a cult.
Okay.
In all seriousness,
I'm going to throw this out there. In my darkest dreams, sometimes I feel like I'd like to be the leader of a sex cult.
Yeah? I can help you with that.
Why not?
I've got several.
No, you haven't, Mike.
Ask me if I have.
Oh.
Ask me.
No.
Ask me if I'm the leader of several sex cults.
Really, what are they called?
Ask me if I'm the leader.
What are they called?
Ask me.
What are they called?
What are they called?
Yeah.
Large One. Church of Large One, sorry. Church of the Large One. And various other
He's
ones that are
right,
too
yeah.
secret to...
Yeah, you sold a franchise, didn't you? That's what I heard.
No, I did, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
So I made my millions.
Yeah, I got to admit, sex cult is quite appealing.
I could run a sex cult.
But I think the appealing thing about cults, which obviously appeals to the megalomaniacal tendencies of people, and obviously strokes the ego, Mike,
I do love
is the idea... Yeah, is the idea of being... You're almost like a demigod, aren't you?
I am indeed, yeah. But we're talking about cults.
Shut up. The idea of being able to control several people at the same time, have them hanging on your every word.
I have them hanging on something.
Yeah, have young women
hanging on
flocking
my,
to...
Yeah. Oh, I have that anyway.
Be deflowered by you, yeah.
I have that anyway.
Sure you do.
Ask me if
well,
I do.
So... You can easily see why it appeals to the slightly more control freak kind of person, and especially one who's very delusional, you know, a very delusional person who thinks they can actually change the world. Mike, do you, just out of interest, we're going to talk about some of the more famous cults or infamous cults rather soon, but just before that, Mike, do you think that cult leaders know exactly what they're doing, or do you think there is a part of them that actually truly believes in what they're saying? You know, about...
I think
say,
there's a split.
Yeah?
I think some of them are truly, sincerely just deluded and do honestly believe in everything they're spouting.
Okay.
But I think some of them probably have ulterior motives.
You have to be incredibly manipulative to get away with, you know, this kind of thing.
Yeah.
I mean, let's face it as well. We're not just talking about... I know you might get the impression when we're talking that we're talking about seducing young women or restless young men who want to fight for something. You know, there are plenty of cults that have picked up people in their 30s and 40s as well. Like, grown adults, experienced adults who are... just enticed by this appealing vision of a better future. So you have
well, they
to
prey on the weak, don't they?
Exactly. You have
wait
to
until something's gone horribly wrong in someone's life.
You have to be incredibly charismatic and manipulative to get away with it. To be, you know, to I can't imagine having that much power, or rather being that cunning to be able to know how to control those kind of people.
I'll teach you.
I bet you will. I thought Des and Troy were all you needed to convince people.
They are normally, yeah. Sometimes I choose to use my mind.
Oh,
and
really?
My charisma.
Okay.
My charm.
Your charisma.
And my penis.
Oh, okay. What?
You heard.
Get out of here.
That's what she said.
But Mike, the number five is an interesting one.
And Mambo number five?
Mambo number five is quite an interesting one. It's one we'll probably return to.
Sorry.
Because the Colts we're going to talk
about. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Sorry, go on.
The Colts we're going to talk about, some of them are kind of pantomime villains, Scientology, and some of them are pretty disastrous and have led to horrible tragedies. And number five particularly might be pertinent for those, entrapment. Because, Mike, sometimes people don't see this, but there's an argument. Good ideas can only flourish in the presence of lots of bad ideas, if that makes any sense.
It does.
What I mean is, if you truly have a good idea, you should feel confident to float it in an ocean of bad ideas, so people hear all sides, and they eventually see your side for the great vision that it is. You get me? The reason that cults clearly fail on this mark is because
it's bloody stupid.
They're very kind of neurotic. You have to isolate people. If you're isolating people, you clearly haven't really got good ideas. You're clearly attempting to indoctrinate them because you're separating them from alternative ideas.
Yeah.
You'll get them in, like you say, you'll lock them in a building or whatever. And they might try and get out now and again, and you say, no, this world's not for you anymore, something like that. Give excuses for why they can't come into contact with anyone else.
Which is where they vary from, obviously, legitimate religions.
Yeah,
because obviously they try to spread the word as much as possible and preach
their teachings. Yeah, that's a good point, That is a good point. That you would probably argue is the difference between legitimate and illegitimate religions. Yeah, no, I like that. Well done. And I also like my idea of, if you have a really good idea, you should be prepared to float it among many bad ideas. Because if yours truly is good, the cream will rise to the top. Yeah. Unfortunately,
which situation you're in, what scenario, because, sometimes if you're with a bunch of bloody idiots, they just can't see what's good.
True, and, there's an argument that the system we live under now, because the media is controlled by very few, very, very powerful people, the really good ideas that might be against their interest won't generally get any coverage anyway. So although you might have a great idea, the really bad ideas come with fireworks and cannon fire and banners.
Yeah.
Whereas yours is just a little whistle in the dark. So where have we got, Mike? Are we starting to scratch the surface of this cult thing?
Oh, I'm scratching something.
I'm just gonna sit a little bit further away right now. But we talk about sex cults, Mike, and we talk about religious cults.
Yeah.
Let's go to the dark side and talk about cults that aim to destroy. And I'm thinking of possibly the most famous cult of all time that even people who aren't really aware of cults as such, like the history of them, would come out with straight away if you said, what does cult mean to you? The Manson family. What do you know about the Manson family then, Mike?
Decent group of people.
Oh yeah, very, very civil minded and...
It's my understanding of
them. I'm not a kind of person who's read tomes and tomes on the Manson family, but clearly Charlie's still in jail, looking as mad and haggard as ever. Yeah, it's often noted that the Manson family is kind of the other side of the coin to the swinging 60s, the decade, the generation of peace and love, and they were the antithesis of that was spawned from that. Of course, Manson was charismatic and completely deluded and insane, and managed to convince all these, I think, former hippies, a lot of them teenage girls, to slaughter a number of people in horrendously grisly ways. Hey yeah yeah, hey yeah yeah. I said, hey, what's growing on? For the uninitiated, Heaven's Gate was a very famous cult that led to a mass suicide in 1997. It was led by a guy called Marshall Applewhite, and a woman called Bonnie Nettles. Weirdly enough, it all started, as you would expect, with a near-death experience where Marshall Applewhite was being treated for, I think, a heart attack by his nurse, Bonnie Nettles. Flash forward, they ended up taking parts of Christian doctrine and mixing it with sort of science fiction and space ideas of space travel. And they believed that the comet Halley-Bopp, which was passing over at a certain time, would be carrying a spacecraft with it, which would take the souls of their members to a better world. So involved in this was Marshall Applewhite, the leader. He convinced all these people to follow him. He also was completely devoted to it himself. They eventually rented a massive mansion, which they all committed suicide in, but they lived a very communal lifestyle, cut off from the wider world. And Marshall Applewhite was one of the few men who actually voluntarily castrated themselves as well. That's how intensely into the ideals of the group they were. They had all kinds of really strange kinks of the group. I mean, they all dressed in black and wore away team armbands, which apparently is a Star Trek reference. And I believe there was a member of the Grateful Dead who also referenced them when he himself committed suicide, saying he was going to join Heaven's Gate on the Halley-Bopp comet. But yeah, basically, over two or three days in March 97, the group committed mass suicide, which involved basically swallowing cocktail of poison before tying plastic bags around their heads to asphyxiate as they were dying. There were only three survivors, which ended with just one, who was charged with making sure that the ideals of the group were sort of discussed and disseminated in future generations. But it's a pretty scary example, Mike, of how one man who, like you say, has this near-death experience and claims to have an epiphany, how he can convince so many other people. Just to let you know as well, the mass suicide, the reason behind the mass suicide, the group apparently didn't believe in suicide, but what was suicide they saw as cleansing the vessels of their bodies for their soul's trip to a better world. Hence, what happened. Nearly 40 people ended up taking part in that, basically, suicide pact.
It's mental, isn't it?
Well, it goes to show the power of human ideas. If you can convey idea, if any rational, logical person was to disseminate all the ideas that Heaven's Gate put forward, they're laughable. You know, they're cut and pasted from various different ideologies. But it's not all about the ideas you have, it's the way you communicate them to people. And clearly Applewhite was a hugely charismatic man, so devoted, you know, like I say, even he himself was prepared to undergo huge sacrifice. I guess it's quite easy to follow someone like that.
I guess.
They're going to collect acolytes if they're, you know, that passionate about something. It's the old thing, isn't it? No matter how stupid an idea is, if you get someone who's good enough at broadcasting it, I hate to bring the Nazis into it again. Look at Hitler. Where would he have been if he wasn't a fantastic orator? If he couldn't communicate, like tap into people's fragile insecurities about their country and their nation and their national pride, if he couldn't tap into that and articulate that in his own chest-thumping way, you know, how could Nazism have ever threatened to take over the world?
Very true.
You can have a good idea, but you don't convey it well, nobody's going to take it on board. You have a stupid idea and you have fantastic ways of communicating it, or you can manipulate it into something a little bit different. You know, that's what gets taken.
It is a great example of that. Like, I can't believe how some guy can just get out of a hospital bed and tell his nurse that they're, what did he say they were? What did he tell her that they were?
I think he told her that he believed they were two witnesses spoken of in the Book of Revelation.
Right, so some old boy who's just had a near-death experience has come out of his hospital bed, just got better. you're his nurse, and he's gone, ah, do you know what? We're them two witnesses, aren't we? from the Book of Revelations? Yeah, that's us.
Of course.
Because of what's just happened, that we are now them witnesses. Because no one's ever recovered from a heart attack before.
Hold on, let me mention two things. Number one, does this not plumb into the most deep-seated insecurity in the human psyche, which is the feeling of worthlessness? This taps into that, doesn't it? Because you're saying we're more than human. We have a purpose, and we're going on to greater things. Especially if you're talking about vulnerable people who've just had a horrible, wasteful life. You know, you're telling them exactly what they want to hear.
She didn't necessarily have a horrible, wasteful life.
No, she was but she was clearly a devoted Christian. Because why would she have been swayed by the Book of Revelations argument otherwise? Think about it. So you have to be...
You say devoted Christian, but their ideals weren't all completely Christian, were they?
Well, no, that's what I mean. They started out from Christian, and then they just basically cut and pasted from all kinds of weird...
And she just went along with it because he told her.
Well, you know what? Women and men get seduced by people, and when you fall in love, maybe, you kind of start believing in people, no matter what kind of bizarre nonsense they start spouting. Like I say, Mipes, passionate person can inspire anyone. They could be talking the biggest load of crap you've ever heard in your life. If their eyes are on fire and they're beating their chest, and sometimes you get sucked into it and you think, you know what, this person really believes what they're saying, you know, they're making me believe in it.
Yeah, but that's bloody mental, isn't it?
And the only other thing I'll mention is, this was in America.
Ah. Suddenly it all makes sense.
I'm not... I don't just mean to write off as, oh, it was only America. What I mean is, America is a breeding ground for religious nuts. I'm not saying that it's the only place for religious nuts, but...
You're saying Americans are dumb.
I'm saying Americans are highly suggestible to ludicrous ideas, yes. If anybody American is listening to this...
Huh?
I was clearly not tarring you all with the same brush. I know there are some very critically thinking and intelligent Americans. I see them on Facebook now and again making very wise comments. And it's a shame that you're overruled by the nut jobs among you. Mike, another... very famous cult, obviously, was the Manson cult that we dipped our toe into.
No, I dipped my toe into something.
Oh, I want to hear that.
You do.
Now, Manson, Mike, much like we talked about the near-death experience of Marshall Applewhite, his epiphany came, like you say, with, for some reason, believing that he was one of the witnesses in the Book of Revelations. Remember the famous thing about Charles Manson? Was it lyric in Helter Skelter or was it backmasking? Probably both. Anyway, it was a lyric, and he, Manson thought it was compelling him to kill all these people. I'm not really sure the connection. But,
what?
But he's another great example. Is he not another great example of how you can take the most ludicrous idea, and if you're charismatic enough and you believe in it and you really like, you know, that spirit of fire burns in your eyes, people just get lured into it, and they're just like, they'll fall at your feet, they'll do your bidding because they think this person knows what they're talking about. It might sound strange to me, but they've got my best interests at heart and I believe what they're saying.
Not really.
Because
you get some bloody nutter standing in the street saying, like, preaching shit to you.
Like, I find them quite funny, I've got them.
What? So they believe what they're saying.
Yeah, but like you've already said, Mike, they're not appealing to you. They're not appealing to someone who can actually critically think and is quite confident. They're appealing to people who probably don't have a very big stake in life, who might have been abused, vulnerable, they don't know where to turn, everyone that they've known has always just treated them like dirt.
I suppose.
This is where these ideas thrive, really. Disenchanted, disenfranchised. I'm surprised there aren't more cults in Britain, to be honest.
There probably are.
The following section has been removed due to copyright infringement. Sorry about that. Fight the power.
Ballad of Jim Jones by the Brian Jonestown Massacre, obviously referring to good old Jim Jones, the leader of the Jonestown Massacre, which I've got to admit I don't really understand myself, one of the great cult suicides, where their communist stroke socialist paradise community just kind of started falling apart, and old Jim, who probably was abusing drugs,
decided everyone needs to kill themselves,
lost his mind, and all of a sudden, yeah. And he managed to actually convince nearly 1,000 people to take their own lives.
How?
Again, you've got to be pretty charismatic to be able to pull that off.
But it's not the...
What?
Weren't they like in search of a better life?
Yeah, but then I think when he lost his mind, he basically convinced them that the world wasn't worth living in anymore, and it had just become like hell on earth.
Wasn't it they wanted to move to Russia? And then Russia said they wouldn't take
because they were obviously the Soviet Union at the time. Because they'd been suspected or were known to have killed a congressman as well as a couple of other people.
So Russia wouldn't take them, so that's it. Then let's all kill ourselves.
Yeah, it's a pretty incredible story. And, interesting fact of the day, that was the largest loss of American civilian life in a non-natural disaster. Well, in history, until September the 11th. So the Jonestown Massacre was, you know, the biggest kind of tragedy disaster up until that fateful day.
It's absolutely crazy.
A mass cult suicide.
I'd encourage all of y'all to actually look this stuff up. Obviously myself and Aaron have been reading through various things, and although pretty disturbing, it gives you kind of a strange insight into how things can work. I don't know, it's the kind of thing
I'd love to
read up on it, because
I'd love to write a dissertation on it.
Yeah,
thing.
Although when reading up on it, I've been frowning at the screen in disbelief of some of the things I'm reading. I haven't stopped reading, so it's like it's interesting.
It's incredible to see the depths to which humans can stoop if they really believe in something. And what they'll do to themselves.
Some of the things, I mean, I'm sure you've all heard of some of this stuff, but don't necessarily know much about it in depth. Some of it's pretty surprising. I'd advise you to read up on it, however somber that may sound.
I mean, there's all kinds of cults that attract people for various reasons. Obviously, we've discussed sex cults, which is my personal favourite. You can also have doomsday cults. I think they're pretty cool as well. Mm. Proclaiming the end of the world. Right, what other cults would you like to see? What about hypnosis in cults? Have you heard of the prospect of that?
Yeah, I guess it's just another way of convincing people.
Yeah, to do things that you might want them to, that they might not agree to otherwise.
I'm quite good at that.
Yeah.
But I'm no hypnotist.
No, you could say the fads of nowadays, the fads, I mean, religions that come and go, Kabbalah, Scientology, obviously, is the major suspect, I guess, nowadays, for a cult. The things they have in common, they all sort of have bizarre ideas that aren't... They don't really have any grounding in fact or evidence. They're just leaps of faith, aren't they, that people get carried away with, because they generally give easy answers, or maybe not easy answers, but they give answers that people want to hear, things to aim for. They're leaps of faith. But in another way, you know, the indoctrination aspect and needing people to, well, convincing people to do things that otherwise it would be very difficult to convince them to do, to toil all day for you, to study all day, to perform sexual activities on you. You know, all these kinds of things. These are the things that governments would love to be able to do to the majority of the population. And is kind of
what,
trying
make
to
them
do.
Perform sexual activities?
Maybe not the sexual activities one, but...
That's the sort of thing I'd love to do to most of the
population. But you look at the way a government, say an unscrupulous government, acts. What do they want their populace to do, mainly? They want them to work hard, not question anything. Just pay attention to propaganda, exactly. They want them to be pretty vapid vessels that are just there to manipulate and be cajoled into doing whatever they need to do. So, you know, governments can slate cults all they want. The American government is possibly the closest thing to a cult in the Western world. The British government clearly wants to emulate them. Other than it not being in a minority, most of the other aspects of cults probably fall within the remit of the American government and other governments.
Really? You know?
I think so.
Explain yourself.
Mind control. What we discussed about cults, the major points of coercive persuasion.
Yeah.
People are put in physically or emotionally distressing situations. Disaster capitalism. People will only accept things being implemented that aren't to their, you know, say, detrimental to them in general, i.e. the state spying on them, higher taxes to pay for wars, you know, being strip searched at airports or at least having x-ray scanners that can see your whole body, these kind of things. People would never ever agree to these things unless events were manufactured to make them terrified. Scared people agree to strange things. Okay, that's one. Number two, their problems are reduced to one simple explanation, which is repeatedly emphasized. Consume. Work, earn, consume. If you can't earn enough, borrow to consume. You need this, you need that, you need the latest. This is what makes you a great person. This is what all the great people will be friends with you for. Number three, they receive what seems to be unconditional love, acceptance and attention from a charismatic leader or group. Okay, that doesn't really apply, does it? They try and give you a sense of belonging, though, again, through consumerism, isn't it? Do you really want to be the only person on the street that doesn't own this? That kind of thing. So number three is a bit iffy, patchy. Number four, they get a new identity based on the group. You know, identity cards. We haven't had them yet, but we've already got lots of identification paraphernalia, haven't we? Passports, driver's license, national insurance.
It's not being given a new identity.
It's being given an identity as a productive citizen, though, and also being demonised if you're not considered a productive citizen. You know, if you're claiming benefits for any period of time, you are less than human. You are dependent on the rest of the hard workers. Number five, they are subject to entrapment, isolation from friends, relatives and mainstream culture. Now, okay, bear with me, this is a little bit abstract. Working at dead-end jobs, that's keeping you away from enlightenment, i.e., you know, furthering yourself, enriching yourself through culture and reading, study, and your family, and your friends, keeps you out of mischief, also drains your body and soul. You know, you get home from work most of the week. Well, yeah, most of the week. Well, what do you do in the evenings most of the time? Recover from work. You know, that's what most of your time off is doing. Sleeping off work, coming down from work. We've discussed this before, okay? Modern Western humans do not need to work 8 hours a day, 5 days a week. There are so many people on the planet, if we increased wages in line, we could employ everyone who needed a job, and everyone would only have to work a four-day week, probably not even 8 hours a day. That would leave more time to buy things, circulate money in the economy, do community work, charity work, all kinds of great things. People would have more time with their families, you'd have less broken homes. Anyway, I don't want to start another cult, but you see what I'm saying?
That's a fairly good idea. But never really looked at it that way.
Yeah, I wrote a blog about it. I'll post my blog on your wall about the four-day week.
Do it. But right now, I take a five-day week. I take 8 hours for 5 days a week.
Well, there you go. I mean, it's ridiculous.
Please.
But do you see what I mean? Okay, I'll admit number three is quite ropey. The state doesn't offer unconditional love, acceptance and attention, although it tries to do it through... Corporations try to do it, like I say, through consumerism. But the other four, I think, really do apply to governments. They operate exactly the same way as cults do. See what I'm saying?
I do, actually.
Wow.
Oh, I'm doing that thing again.
Oh, you grit. Zing. Mike agreed with me. That means I get to put his pants down, have him over the desk.
Oh, poo. Yeah. Tell us what cults you intend to start up.
Found. Yeah, post
declare your
allegiances.
Allegiance to my cult.
To the Church of Large.
To the Church of Large.
And please, yeah, post all of your deviant sex cults on our page. hopefully with pictures and videos. Good night.
Good night.